So this time in Lagos, we'll be looking at growing and developing in faith. That's the theme. The theme is growing and developing in faith. All right? And we'll look at everything we need to look at concerning growing your faith and developing in it. These 3 days. We'll have 1 hour each day. And remember, it's a seminar. So if it is a seminar, you should try and write down as much as you can. Praise God. Father, we are grateful this beautiful morning. We thank you for who you are. We thank you for what you mean to us. We are just grateful to be your children. We are grateful to be here. But as we get into your word, Holy Spirit, the one who breathed on the word, we thank you because you are here. We brought you here. We thank you because you are our comforter, our counselor, our helper, our advocate, our intercessor, our strengthener, our standby. Spirit of wisdom, understanding, counsel, might, fear. The one that takes what belongs to the Father and opens it up to us. The teacher. We adore you this morning to learn from you. Teach both the teacher as well as the hearer this morning. In the mighty name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. Amen. So I like to start by saying that faith is God's love language. Praise God. Faith is his love language. I've tried to get into the scripture, you know, to see if there is any other way we can approach him without faith. And there is none. Hebrews 11:6 tells us that. Without faith is what? Impossible. So, remember, there are many scriptures that tell us nothing is impossible. Is that true? There are scriptures in the Bible that tell us nothing is impossible. And we like that. We love it. It's beautiful. So with God, all things are possible. All things are possible to him who believes. Impossible is nothing. Impossible is nothing. Well, that's true. Amen. But the Bible tells us in that Hebrews 11:6 that without faith, it is what? That's that word, impossible. That you can't please God without faith. It's impossible to please him. It's impossible. So, you know, when you come for meetings like this, all you are talking about, faith. Is this all these people talk about? Well, we are trying to see if we should talk about something else, but we can't. We've tried. Because if they say that we talk about something else, and then we do without faith, it's impossible to please him, and we want to please him, isn't it? So that means everything we should talk about should be what? In faith. So you're talking about prayer, we should be talking about faith. Is that true? So we must talk about faith. That's all I'm trying to say. For people who are here and already skeptical, I know them. Very soon now, they pick up the mic, they're talking about faith. Well, Pastor Tok started it last night. You rarely can hear us talk without faith. Because without it, we can do nothing. Is someone understanding? Is his love language? How many of us know how love languages work? I'm seeing a lot of people who are not married here. Okay, well, the long and short of it is that love someone the way they want to be loved, not the way you want to love them. That's love language. Is someone understanding? So your love language, for example, may be physical touch. And your husband, you know, you married a typical type A Igbo man who likes cash. You understand? If you are crying, he uses cash to slap you around a little. But that's not your love language. You know, no matter how many billions he keeps down there, if he doesn't touch you, it's not your love language. So God has told us that his love language is what? Faith. So it's not your duty to love him any other way except the way he wants to be loved. So you better get into the word of God and understand what faith is. But what I even came to tell us this morning, because we are talking about growing and developing in faith, what I came to tell us this morning is, you know, do we even have the faith? This faith they are talking about, before we talk about growing it and developing it, you should have something, is it not true, before you can grow it and develop it. So today, I'm going to be putting up a few points to you to show you that as you are seated here now as a believer, you have faith. Is someone understanding? You have faith because this is the problem. So some people are not understanding that they've been equipped with a measure of faith. You have it. You know, it's not a question of what God is going to give you. It's a question of what he has already given you. Because, you know, we have this mentality of approaching him with Father, give me. I beg. We so beg. You know, I like to say this. I say, Father, just help us in this country. Begging has almost become second nature. And the Lord told me that scripture dropped in my spirit. So I started running inside the room. The room is small, so I couldn't run like this. So I was just running around. It looked like I hadn't seen it before. And then he taught me a few things. And I tell him, I said, well, I'm going here to teach faith today. He says, I'll tell you when you tell me. Look at it. It says, therefore, let no man glory where? In men. In men. So you know what he told me? He said, my people glory in ministers, in commissioners, in governors, in presidents. Don't glory in men. I don't care which type of men. So the background of the story, please, when you get home, you read the whole three. Now, these Corinthian Christians, in fact, Paul called them carnal. He said, because they were envious and in strife. And what made it so? Because these guys will come together and there is a dichotomy. And they are saying, no, we belong to Paul. The other ones are saying we belong to Apollos. And some others are saying we belong to Cephas. That's actually Peter. And then Paul sees this thing, you know, where they have just divided themselves according to who they belong to. So Paul comes to scold them about it. That's why he made this comment. So just follow me. He said, therefore, let no man glory in men. In other words, don't glory in me. You understand? Don't glory in Apollos. He said, for all things are what? Yours. Now, if he had stopped there, that would be enough. Then he starts to say the all things that are ours. What did he say? He said, whether who? The Paul, you know, they were trying to, you know, join. Or Apollos, or Cephas, or the world. This is scripture. Hello. Is it in your Bible? Or the world. Did you see that? Or what? What's following? Or life. Life. Life is yours. Life is yours. Then this is the one that made me start running around. Or what? Death. Do you know what this means? You know you were born and you took flesh after the first Adam. Is that true? So the Bible also records that this body is perishing. In other words, it's built in such a way, it's death doomed. So yes, if you live long enough, you will die. But death, you have mastered death. You tell death when to come or when not to. Death does not have any authority over you except that which you allow. Is someone understanding? Or life or death. So this thing we say and we go around and all we are talking about is, we don't know. God give it, God take it, blessed be the name of the Lord. We don't know, we can go out in the morning, in the evening, we don't know whether we'll be alive or dead. We see people who have had accidents, we say, hey, yeah, that's the way God wanted it. No, stop it. Whether life or death. Then he said, all things that are what? Present. All things that are what? To come. All are yours. And you are Christ's. And Christ is God's. All things are yours. Stand up. All things are mine. I don't know about you. All things are mine. Everything is mine. Did you hear that? Life or death, people even are mine. The answer to me. All things are ours. Yes, all things are mine. And all things are yours. Praise God. Let's be seated. I just needed us to know that. But you see, this thing we are talking about, if you don't believe it, you know you walk away from here crying. You walk away from here panicking before the enemy. We have authority. Someone understand it. So what do we have? That's what I came to share this morning. Do we truly have this faith? Can we get scriptures that show us what we have? Because if you don't know what you have, you can't use it. You can't apply it. How many of us know what I'm talking about? Yes, you can't. So do we have faith? Has God done something concerning faith towards us? So let's get into the scriptures. I'm going to give you seven witnesses to show you that we have faith. At the point of getting born again, you had faith. God gave you faith. He gave you a measure of faith. And then the other days, we'll talk about how to grow and develop this faith. Praise God. 2 Thessalonians 1:3. It says, we are bound to thank God always for you, brethren, as it is meet, because that your faith does what? Grows exceedingly. And the charity of every one of you towards what? Each other. Sorry. Let's go to Romans 12:3. I'll come to that growing exceedingly. That's talking about our faith growing. Romans 12:3 says, for I say through the grace given unto you, to every man that is among you, not to do what? Think of himself more highly. So note, we are supposed to think of ourselves highly, but not more highly. Praise God, before people will leave here now and think they shouldn't think of themselves highly. He said, we're supposed to think of ourselves highly, but not more highly, all right? Than he ought to think. But to think what? Soberly. According as God has done what? Dealt to every man the measure of faith. The measure of faith. When I tried to understand this scripture initially, the example God gave me, you know, like Pastor Tox was saying yesterday, if it's not simple, it's not God. You understand? Mm-hmm. If it's simple, it's God. God doesn't want to bamboozle us. He just wants to make everything easy for us to understand. So, you know, it's, how many of us know muscles? Maybe because I'm in the medical line. You know muscles. All of us have the same number of muscles. Did you know that? When you are born, we all have the same number of muscles. Huh? So, now, what is the difference between those people you see, you know, in jeans, you know, that have, that are ribbed? I'm talking about 12-pack. You know, not just 6, but 12. And, you know, the man that has one central pack. What do you think is the difference? What do you think? You think maybe God loves the ribbed man more? What's the difference? Somebody did something about what they have or with what they have. Is that true? So that's what he used to, you know, show it to me. So he has given us, just like we all have muscles at birth, he has given us the measure of faith. Some translations will say a measure of faith. But the important thing that he has given us the same quantity. To every man, did you know that? He says to what? Every man. To every man. He has dealt to every man the measure of faith. That's Romans 12:3. Now, who is he talking to here? Because there's a scripture I want to show you now that people stay on and think it's not them they are talking to. Who is he talking to here? Romans 1:7. We can see that. He says, to all that be in Rome, beloved of God, called to be saints, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. So who is it? Who is the Roman? Is Paul writing to here? The Romans. Believers. Is that true? Saints. Okay? Amen. Now, there is this other scripture, 2 Thessalonians 3:1-2. Let's look at it. He says, finally, brethren, pray for us that the word of the Lord may have free cause and be glorified, even as it is with you. And that we may be delivered from unreasonable and wicked men. For all men have not faith. Did you see that? This one says all men have not faith. So what men do you think they are talking about here? The unbelievers. Is that true? Are you an unbeliever? Okay, so the one that applies to you is Romans what? 12:3. That's the one that applies to you. Okay, not this 2 Thessalonians 3:1-2. Okay, so you have been dealt a measure of faith. Let that settle. You have it. They gave it to us for free. Praise God. So, other men, what kind of faith do they have? Natural human faith. Unbelievers have natural human faith. You know, the type that Thomas exhibited. How many of us know that type of faith? Except I put my hand here and here, I will not believe. That's natural human faith. Because people want to see before they believe. But this God kind of faith in Mark 11:22, you know, where Jesus speaking to said, have faith in God. They say the right translation there, it should be what? Have the God kind of faith. So this God kind of faith is the faith we are talking about here. The one that has been dealt to every believer. Now, unbelievers have natural human faith where they want to see. So in other words, if you want to see first before you believe, you know who you're acting like? Okay, I didn't say. You just said, thank you. Amen. That's the first witness. The second witness, faith is a gift of God. Now, that word gift there is the word doron. It means, you know, a present. You know, present. When you give somebody a present. Did they ask you for it? Not necessarily. Okay, although people are asking for presents these days. But generally, when you're giving somebody a gift, it's something that came from your heart. Something you could afford. It is free, isn't it? Whatever they do with the gift thereafter, I mean, you can't be bothered. Amen. So, but this is a gift. Faith is a gift of God, which he has given to all of us. Let's look at the scripture. Ephesians 2:8. For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is what? The gift of God. It is the gift of God. Did you see that? God knew we would need it. That's why he gave it to us. He didn't want to leave it for conjecture. You know, whether or whether not. No. He knew we would need it to walk on earth today. Because it's that hand that reaches into the invisible and takes that which belongs to us, brings it down, making it what? Tangible. That's faith. So he knows we will need it. Is someone understanding? He knows we will need it. My first daughter, she's had some, you know, some things with surgery. When she was around 13 years or so, you know, when she was born anyways, you know, there are these two plates that are in the abdomen. Hers didn't close up. So it became a very serious hernia. You know, the doctor, the pediatrician told us then that it will likely close up. That so some, you know, quite a number of people that theirs will take time before closing, that she just may just be there, may be a part of it. So she went to secondary school, boarding house. Every weekend, almost every day, they were calling us. She's in pain. She's in so much pain. You know, so one of those days I brought her back home and took her to see a doctor. And, you know, when we saw, you know, where I was working that time, after seeing the doctor said, well, she's now older than, you know, much older than, you know, the thing, that the thing may not cover up. So that the best thing to do would be to go in, you know, to, this is not an intermediate surgery, it's a major surgery. They're going to rip her from here down and then try and fix the plates, you know. But what had happened is because of the hernia, he had become strangulated. He could become strangulated very easily. So when we went to do the scan, they showed me from the scan. I was in the scan room. That was the hospital where I was working. And they showed me, you know, she was like this. And you could see that her intestines were coming out from the hole. I could see it. So if it closes up, it wraps up around the intestine, you know, anything can happen. That's what's called strangulated hernia. And it can be immediate death, really. Or sometimes she may not know it's happening and there may not be pain. So this was the situation we were facing that time. Is someone understanding? So they immediately scheduled us for a surgery. Immediately, I had picked her on Friday. We've done all the, they got this, they scheduled us for a surgery. Immediately, they said Monday. Now, they wanted to do it that day, but the surgeon, they had to call in the surgeon. I'll usually get half off. But if they called in the surgeon that day, I won't, because the surgeon comes from another place. So I told them, let's do it Monday. Well, I thank God for, you know, the ability to raise my children with faith in this thing we are talking about. So I called her. I said, well, this is the diagnosis. You know, you are going to have a surgery on Monday. We don't even know if you can go back to school because it has to really heal before you can go back to school. I said, what do you want? I think apparently she wasn't understanding, you know, the story I was gisting with the doctor. She said, I said, yeah. She said, oh, surgery. I said, yes. And it's neither simple nor intermediate kind. It is a major surgery. She said, I said, yes. You know, just then she was even quite little. In her simplicity of her, she said she didn't understand that it's surgery. I said, okay, in case you didn't understand, now you know. Because this is a girl that I've known her to walk in faith. You understand? I said, now you know. But the surgery is not today. It's not Friday. It's going to be Monday. So Monday we will go. Brethren, brothers and sisters, that weekend, my duty was to look for money. My duty and her father's duty, so that we can make payment, you understand, for the surgery. So we were running around looking for the money, honestly, so that I don't lie here. I didn't pray. I wasn't the one going into surgery. Someone understanding. I felt that she understood because they learned this thing quite early. Immediately we got into Rhema, all of us like got into Rhema. By the way, if you're here, get your whole family into Rhema. Good. So all of us got into Rhema. So everybody was learning during the, to your tent, O Israel. You know, God doesn't have grandchildren. How many of us know? We are all his children. There is a God in heaven and I'm not him. So that was how we raised them. So we just did our thing normally. Then she packed her bags for Monday. Monday we went to the hospital. When we got to the hospital on Monday, the surgeon has to do his own thing. They have called him in. He was scrubbed and waiting. We had gone late, so he was scolding me. He wasn't happy. He said I was wasting his time. I was begging and saying, sorry. And they said, we should come and lie down here. Let him check. The guy, my daughter, lay down. The guy started palpating. He said, who is the person that is supposed to have this surgery? I said, sir, it's my daughter. It cannot be me, as you can see. I brought her, you know, because he was already angry. He said, why? He was so irritated that morning. He said, why am I disturbing him? That this girl doesn't need a surgery. I said, sir, calm down, sir. I said, sir, I brought out all the reports that we are giving just 3 days prior and showed him. Is someone understanding? I said this. He said, no, this results can't be this girl. I said, okay. He said, who wrote it? I said, I was there in the scan room. He said, let us go. I said, okay. So we went to the scan room. She laid down again. The same thing we saw on Friday, we didn't see. Is someone understanding? It had all gone. Now, the 250,000 that time, do you know what I'm talking about? It's still money here, the talkless of them. That 250, we went to use it to eat ice cream that day. God knows. It's on. Now, I had to ask her while we were eating ice cream. I said, come. Tell me what happened. She said, I said that the surgery would be painful. I said, yes. She said, I said she would stay out of school for a while. I said, yes. She said she just went back to God and said, that she's sorry or that she has been taking this thing lying lightly. That she doesn't want it. There is no surgery. And this girl was looking at me as if it wasn't a big miracle that had happened. Is someone understanding what I'm talking about? Your faith. You have that measure. Is there? Just last month, she started having this same girl. She started having this cyst in her armpit. Now, where we went to are people who know my history. If you know my history, you know that my mom had stage 3 breast cancer. So anything that is happening around here, they are panicking on my behalf. I didn't send them. So my daughter was having this cyst on and off. Cyst, you know, it would leak and then it would dry up. It would start again. So we went for scan again. When we finished, they said no, that they have to remove it, that they don't want story, that they must remove it. They scheduled us for another surgery. When they called the amount, usually, if nothing changes, money will usually reset your brain. I'm not even kidding you. Money will reach usually. Immediately, I thought it was, I was like, okay, no big deal. Let us, No. They called the amount. I said, how? Jesus paid it all. So how? I said, no. Not at all. I called her again. I said, have you forgotten? She said, no, she hasn't. That is true, sir. She has been just taking it lightly. That she will go back again. Honestly, you know one thing? I went to teach in Rhema. This last one I went to teach. She sends us a picture. Because I ended up seeing my husband somewhere down the line. She sends us a picture. And I saw 3 rows of hair. Do you know hair? When you plug hair, 3 rows. One picture. I said, what is this? She said she just woke up this morning. The thing opened and the rows fell out. That she saw it on her bed. So she picked it and she saw where it was coming from. The thing just dried up completely. Is someone understanding? Just right. You see, faith is not voking something. You know, some of us think, like Pastor Tosh was saying, that God needs to do gym. You understand? It's, no. It is our nature. It's our natural habitat. We've all been dealt the measure of faith. You have it. I have it. It's a gift. Praise God. So we believed God for one of the greatest things, or the greatest thing that can ever happen to any human being. And that is the fact that you believe what Jesus did, you confess it with your mouth, and the person that said that thing, the Bible says, is no longer who they used to be. So So you are going around and they are asking you, I say, yes, I'm born again. We are looking at you, it's the same dress you wore. If you were dark, you've remained dark. Is someone understanding? Nothing has changed physically. But you believe that you have become a son of God. That's what faith got you. That's what it got you. So if you so believe, is it these little things that are difficult for you? Is it healing? Is it prosperity? Is it joy? Is it peace? You've used your faith to believe the most important thing ever in life. And how did that happen? Point three. I'm giving you five witnesses. I've given you the second witness. The third witness. Romans 10:17. So then, faith comes by what? And hearing by what? The word of God. So we heard the gospel preached, like I said. And then we believed. And we confessed. And we did what? Became born again. We became born again. Our dead spirits were recreated. Is someone understanding? We became like Christ. That's how we got born again. And you know it. The Spirit himself bore witness with your spirit that you have become a child of God. That's how we got born again. So, note, the Bible said that faith comes by what? Hearing. And the hearing by what? God's word. John 6:63. The words that I speak to you, they are what? Spirit. And they are what? Life. So, God's word is anointed. When we heard it, we believed it, and it produced. So we became born again. So God himself is a faith God. Have you ever looked at it that way? That someone came to the scene of chaos in Genesis 1 and then spoke and it became. He didn't go to check if what he spoke would happen or not. That's faith. And we are his children. Is that true? So we are the faith children of what? The faith God. And God has given us the paraphernalia for being his children. That's his word. So when you hear it, it will produce. We will see more of what we can do to grow this faith. Because we have what? Faith. Amen. Hebrews 11:3 says, through faith, we understand that the worlds we are framed by the word of God, so that things which are seen, we are not made of things which do appear. It's through faith. We understand it. Apostle Tox was also saying here yesterday, it's something that, you know, I don't know if you ever get to the point where it seems like you can't wrap your mind around some things. God did it that way normally. That we are talking about galaxies. You know, the scientists, astronomers, they know nothing. They haven't started and they will never know. Let's not. You see, the bigger their telescopes, the more they see. That's how it works. So if they make a bigger telescope today, they'll see more. One day, the Lord was telling me that I should go and research that these stars that we see. You see the stars? How many of us know I'm talking about? That their lights, that those stars ceased to exist billions of years ago. That what we are seeing today is their light. Go online. Google is your friend. We can't understand this thing. Is someone understanding? They've given us enough to work with. You can't. That's the kind of God we have. That's the kind of God we serve. That's how mighty he is. Yet he lives in us. And yet he says, all things are yours. I don't know. Light became. Everything he said, he got. That's the kind of God that is your God. Sometimes, perhaps, when you have problems, and I know these things happen, maybe you should just sit down a little bit and think thoughts of how big your God is. Usually, it solves problems. It helps me. I don't know about it, but try it, you see. Because immediately we have a problem. We are swallowed by it. Hey, how are we going to get out of this? Hey, what will we do? Hey, it really looks very bad. Have you ever thought that the things you worried about yesterday never came to pass? Those things you feared about last year, hello? For those who love fear, doubt, worry, those things, just think by this time last year, you had a list of things you were afraid for. Have you noticed that they've changed? This year. And the funny thing is that none of them from that last year came to pass. Have you seen how the enemy keeps you in worry? Meanwhile, the one that is your daddy, papam, is completely in charge and running things that concern me. At least to the extent I allow him. That's our Father. That's the kind of God we have. Praise God. So it's through faith you understand it. So whatever the scientists are telling us, listen, brethren, if there is a time you need faith, it's today, Sha. It's today. Have you even realized that even if you go off social media, you still need faith? The one you need for today, our parents didn't really need that amount. Today, you enter like this and people are telling you that a man is now a woman. You are wondering. You are looking. You are imagining. Then you want to go and ask, did the man, did they get a womb? People are confused and they are dispersing confusion. If there is a time that we need to teach this thing, in fact, everywhere you see a faith seminar, go. It is important. Because you are looking at things, they are telling you that lie is now truth. You are watching, but this used to be a lie. And the people around you are saying, no, forget it, it has become truth. If you stay there long enough, you start seeing that lie as truth. This is the time you need faith. There is nothing that is not out there. And the Lord is depending on us to dispense the real thing. But if you don't know it, how can you do it? You have faith. You got born again, you have faith. Like it or not, you have faith. The thing there is what you are doing with it. But do you have it? Yes. And in case you are here, I know there are no such people here, who go around looking for people or praying for faith to come. Anyway, they come and teach us about prayer. I say that if we, the number of hours we pray, I believe, possible. No statistics yet, but I think this country, the most praying country. Right. First of all, we have the numbers. You know, you can't overlook Nigeria anymore, the scheme of things. Approaching 300 million, so don't even, you don't like us, you hate us, you need our money. So Nigeria is good. Someone understand it. This nation is good. Did you hear me? Yes, we are good. Looking at you people, now those who are trying to jab, forget it. This, now here we dey. You hear me, but we are here. We are here. God is not stupid. He didn't wake up and say, I put Chiemezie Anyanwu here mistakenly. No. I am here for a time as this. We pray. We know how to. Somebody is praying 40 hours straight. How? If someone understands, then the problem becomes, what are the results? So what do you think will make us not have the kinds of results we should be getting? Because there is a reason they're telling us to pray. Pray that you may receive and that your joy may be full. Is that true? But why aren't people getting the results? Because they haven't even gone into God's word. They don't know what God is saying. They don't know how to apply the principles. People do anything anyhow and they want to get results. We have faith. You like it, you don't like it. If you like, go today and pray for 40 hours for faith. You won't get it that way. Faith comes by what? Hearing God's word. Praise God. Fourth witness. 2 Corinthians 4:13. He says, we having the same spirit of faith. According as what? It is written. I believed, and therefore have I spoken. We also believe, and therefore what? Speak. Did you see that? The Bible said we have the same what? Spirit of faith. Okay, there's this thing that people say. They say, you know, the faith is taught, but the spirit of faith is caught. Okay, it depends on how you look at it. You know, it's looking as if it's transmitted. You know what I'm talking about. So like when you are around somebody who has faith now, you know, and they like you, you know, they will inject it small into you and then you have it. That's not what it's saying. You know, God is our father, is the father of faith. All right. Now, if you look at it from the perspective that when you walk with people who operate in faith, there is a tendency for you to begin to walk like, you know, association influence. You know what I'm talking about? Yes. Something like that. That's why sometimes you have to look around, not sometimes, all the time. You have to look around the people that are around you. Look at them. You see, in this time, you don't need everybody. Did you hear me? People don't like to say this, but I know, walking like this, I know what is done for me. Sometimes there is a pruning that will happen. Father, use me, use me. Do you know what you are praying? Are you understanding? Use you, use you. By the time they are done removing the people that are against him using you, you may change your breakdance. Is someone understanding? Let's be careful the people that are around us, because some of them will sap the faith you have. Do you have such friends? You finish arranging yourself. You are studying. Again, the thing there with faith is like it's a balloon. Once they, you know, you blow, we are blowing balloon. It may take you minutes to blow it full. Just with one prick of needle, bam, it's done. It's deflated. There are some people you don't need around you. So it's based on that people say spirit of faith. No, the spirit of faith is still the same spirit of faith that who gives? The father of faith gives. That's God. So you have it. That's all I'm trying to say. The only thing is that you need to be around people that will help you to walk it, to practice it, to be in it. Don't be around people that when you see them, you say, I believe God. They say, nah, calm down. Let's be realistic. No. Did you hear me? No. I believe God. You don't need them. You walk away. You have your feet. Take a walk. Some of us are where we are today because of the friends we've surrounded ourselves with. You know, I want to specifically thank and appreciate our alumni. Yes, you guys are good. The ones that are coming for the program will continue to come. Because the Rhema family is not a family you leave. Some of us have been here now for the past 12 years. Yes. Some 13. We came, we never left. What do you think? That they came to recruit us? We came, we never left. Because there was a benefit. So during the week, you just go out, you see all sorts of things. Nyama, nyama everywhere. Then for us in Abuja, Tuesday you land for healing school. Or Sunday you land for prayer school. When you come, they'll reset your brain, arrange it, clean it up. And then you go out again into life struggle. Is someone understanding? But some people come and all they do is they take all those classes. When they are done, they disappear. You never see them. By the time you see them, the devil has shown them shege. You know shege promax. And then we start again. Is someone understanding? Listen to me. I used to have a member of our class, charter class. Pastor Akuna and I, Reverend Akuna and I, we are in charter class. She likes to say that they are twins. You know, charter class members. We had two classes that made up the charter. I'm talking about the original charter. I'm not talking about charter Lagos. No, there is original. There is just a class that is called charter. Then you have Lagos charter. You have Port Harcourt. Once you have to put a city to your charter is abnormal. So I'm talking about the original charter. Are you understanding? So they themselves came in first. And then because they wanted, they now took, there was another intake, and that was when I came in. So she likes to say that, you know, even when it comes to twins, one came out first. So I defer to that. I agree. Okay, so, well, we are charter. So we came in, and we are handling some of these truths. In case you were here and you're not a student, You see, I'm not begging you. Hear me, ba? I'm not. Remain where you are. When things change, nobody will tell you that jungle has matured. Stay there. I'm not begging anybody. No. Partners, don't go around. Don't give them anything. Stay where you are. Don't come running to come and join Rhema. By the time when we entered Rhema, things we are seeing stars, my husband and I. He had just finished an election which he lost. We were so broke that broke people were calling us broke. We needed what we got. So when we came into Rhema, we said, like this. That's why we never left. Because this is our company. It's our company. There is no how you get into this place and you don't find someone who will encourage you in faith. There is no how. You like them, you hate them. Someone will come and say, sister, continue. The Lord is seeing you. Give you some words of encouragement. This is our company. We go nowhere. No leave, no transfer. Praise God. So the Corinthian Christian was carnal. But the Bible is telling us here that we, that's Paul writing, says we having the same spirit of faith. Hey, Kana, those two epistles, you need to go through them. The irony that church was sometimes, you are not able to understand it. You know, they lack no gift. They come behind it, no gift. Then somebody sleeping with their father's phone. Is someone understanding? You know, the things don't match. The Corinthian church, extremely, Paul called them carnal. Extremely carnal church. Yet, they had the spirit of what? At least you're not as carnal as them, hopefully. Is someone getting it? So, it's not an anointing, per se, that you catch, you know, by association, environment, influence. Not at all. God gives it, you have it. It's your duty to do what? Walk in it. Fifth witness. 2 Peter 1:1. It says, Simon Peter, a servant and an apostle of Jesus Christ, to them that have done what? Obtained what? Like precious faith with us through the righteousness of God and our Savior who? Jesus Christ. Did you see what they said there? They said we have what? Obtained like precious faith with them through the righteousness of God. So Simon Peter is the one writing this. How many of us know Simon Peter? Do you know him? Praise God. You see, the Bible covers everything, shall. It's your duty to go in. Just saying. If you are having problems with people, you don't have any excuse not to walk in love. You can ask Jesus. Jesus went and collected 12 men who had major issues. Is someone understanding? They had major issues. Yeah, I'm thinking if I was Jesus that time, thank God I'm not him. Somewhere down the line, I would have dissolved my cabinet. Completely. Is it that he didn't know? Have you ever wondered? These guys, sometimes they are mature. Some other times they are extremely childish. Is someone understanding? Peter was a very exuberant person. But he didn't have the faith to carry out that exuberance. So you see someone walking off on water. You say, if it be you, bid me come. Will Jesus say it's not him? Jesus said, oh yeah, come. We know the rest of the story. And you know, Peter, even in the epistles, he still carried over some of that childish thing. Go to Galatians 2 and see the fight he had with Paul. So be calming down. Humans have their issues. Are you understanding me? Or you must love them anyways. James and John woke up one morning and collected their mother. Now, if they went alone, it would be different. They took their mother. How do two grown men go to a mom
if you are mother and say, mommy, join us. We want to go and meet the master. So that when you get there, you tell him, when he gets into his kingdom, let James sit by the right and let John sit by the left. And their mother followed them. Then Judas. We know Judas's story. Judas was scheming for more money, despite the fact that he was paying all his bills from the general funds. 419. Then Thomas was the one that said, I don't care. See, those guys had their issues. But this is Peter writing. After he had received Christ, as he ought to, his own understanding, and received the baptism of the Holy Spirit, and we could now boldly preach, and 3,000 will be added per day. This was what he said. He said that what? We have obtained like precious faith with him. With him. That's the faith we have. Your faith is not inferior. Because I think sometimes we look at some people and we say, that faith they say I have can't be like this type that Brother Hagin had. It's not inferior. This is Peter speaking to us. Like precious faith. Same one he had, same we have. So you are reading up about this big man of God that have lived in this last century. Some of us have, men, of course, I know quite a number of us have read God's generals. You know what? That's the first, the second, the third, the fourth. Try and read some of those things those guys did. You know, first of all, you begin to question yourself if you are, you know, first of all, serving the same God, if it's the same faith. You know what I'm talking about? But you know, these are men who just dared to believe. A.A. Allen, Jack Coe, Etrin Kuma, us Brother Hagin is there. Is someone understanding? William Marion Graham. These were men who just took God at his word. Like precious faith. You have it, I have it. Dare to use it. Who's there? That's the fifth witness. Praise God. We have the same faith. Sixth. Giving you seven witnesses. The sixth witness, Jude 3. Jude has only one chapter. Go to verse 3. He says, beloved, when I gave all diligence to write unto you of the common salvation, it was needful for me to write unto you and exhort you that you should earnestly contend for what? The faith which was once what? Delivered unto the saints. Did you see that? Once delivered unto the saints. Delivered. What is delivery? You guys, you know, you have Korea, a lot of Korea people. When they deliver your present, it's delivered. You know, one place we saw it as a gift. Is that true? You deliver gifts. That's Jude 3. Faith has been delivered to us. Did you notice that in all of these things, you haven't done anything at all? This all originated from who? God. It was his idea. It was his idea. And he gave it to us. We didn't ask. Perhaps the way things are structured today, if he waited for all of us to ask before giving. I hope you know there are some people who won't get. Eh? The people who pay bigger tithe and offering will be giving first. Some people won't even ask because they'll stay at home, look at themselves and disqualify themselves. But no, God gave it to us. You have, if you go out with nothing else from here today, just know that you have the measure of faith fully packaged, delivered as a gift to you from your Father God. Simple. Know it. Because if you don't, you won't use it. You have faith. It's been delivered unto us. Praise God. The seventh witness. 2 Corinthians 6, 14 to 16. 14 to 16. I love this scripture. It says, but be ye not unequally what? Yoked together with unbelievers. For what fellowship has what? righteousness with unrighteousness. And what communion has light with darkness? And what concord has Christ with Belial? Or what part has he that believeth with an infidel? And what agreement has the temple of God with idols? For you are the temple of the living God. As God has said, I will dwell in them, and I will walk in them, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. So this clearly demarcates two kingdoms. Let's look at this scripture so that you know what God is calling you. Or some of us have called ourselves names they didn't send us. So look at that. They said we should not be. That's speaking to the Corinthian Christians. Paul is writing, you believers, do not be unequally what? Yoked with unbelievers. So believers one side, unbelievers one side. Is that one side, the other side? Is that true? Now look at that. For what fellowship has what? Righteousness. So who is called righteousness here? The believer. With unrighteousness. Who is unrighteousness? The unbeliever. These are names that we are called them. Direct names. And what communion has what? Light. So what did they call you there? Light. And what did they call the unbeliever? And truly they are darkness. Then 15. What concord has what? They called us what? Did you see that? And then they called the unbeliever what? Belial. That's the enemy, the devil. We are Christ. Scripture. If any man be in Christ Jesus, he's a new creation. Kainos kitisis. All things are what? Behold, all things have become new. Is someone understanding? That word, kainos, is a species that has never been seen before. Kainos kitisis. It wasn't in existence till after what Jesus did. So you see, the enemy went after one Christ. But when that Christ resurrected, he brought up many Christs. That's why they call you Christ. Hey, but think about it now. Not be your father's name you carry. You understand? Why are we, you know, we like to be humble in things they didn't send us to. My name is Chichi Christ. You like it, you don't like it, is your business. Is someone understanding? That's what they called me here. Oh. That's what they call you. Have a problem? Come and sort it out here. This is my name. And then, well, and what part has he that does what? Believer. Did you see what they called us here? We are called what? He that believeth. I am a believer, and believers believe. There is no such thing as an unbelieving believer. Believers believe. I'm a believer. They said, I am he that believeth. So at those times when it's looking like you can't have faith in that thing, say, but no, God sees me differently. The same way he saw Gideon. Remember Gideon? He sent someone. He said, the person came and said, ah, thou man of valor. Gideon looked around and checked. Who are you talking about? He said, it's you. I'm talking to you. He said, no, I come from the list of the tribes of Israel, and you're calling me a man of valor. Today, I have come to introduce yourself to you. Be on your feet. You are righteousness. Hallelujah. You are the righteousness of God in who? Christ. You are light. Your father is the chief light. You are light. That's who you are. You are Christ. Did you hear that? Personally and collectively, that's who we are. And then all things are yours. Did you hear that? All things are yours. Whatever it is, they are mine. Paul himself said, even us, you people are struggling for, we are yours. That's what Paul said. He said, whether it's Paul, it is Apollos, it is Cephas, we have been given to you. We belong to you. Whether life or death or things that are present or things that are to come, all things are yours. Maybe some things are ours.
Are you sure? All things. Oh, all things are mine. You know what that means? That means everybody is working for me. This economy is working for me. Yes, Nigeria is working for me. Everything is working in my favor. It can't but work in my favor. All things are mine. Did you hear me? All things are mine. Every single thing is mine. Hallelujah. It is mine. Amen. Say after me, I'm a believer. I am he that believeth. I am not a doubter. I do not walk in unbelief. I am a member of the body of Christ. So then, I am Christ and I belong to Christ. I am the righteousness of God in Christ. I am Christ. I am the temple of God. All things are possible to me. All things are possible to me. All things are possible to me. I walk in faith all the time. I am healed. I am the healed of the Lord. And all things are mine. If you believe it, make a joyful noise unto the Lord.